So I'll present to you in this talk a summary of my dissertation research. My dissertation is motivated by the fact that we see the digital revolution all around us, except in official macroeconomic statistics. So one of the most fundamental questions in economics is, how are we doing? Traditionally, we look at metrics such as GDP and other metrics such as productivity, which are derived from GDP, look at changes in these metrics over time, and then use them as proxies for changes in well-being. But it's important to note that GDP and productivity are measures of production, and they are not meant to directly measure well-being, but we continue to use these metrics for lack of better alternatives. This relationship between GDP and well-being breaks down completely in the current digital age because we have an explosion of free digital goods. Many of us spend hours every day online on platforms such as Google and Facebook and other online platforms, especially even more now in the COVID age when we are working virtually. But most of the products which we use, including Zoom, probably MIT is paying for it, but many of the other online platforms, including Skype, which we use to communicate with our friends, are free. If you look at the share of the information sector as a percentage of GDP, it has remained at around 4 to 5% for the last 40 years. You know, so clearly, all of us use technology much more now than we did 40 years ago. But many of the benefits which we get from digitization do not directly show up, and they're not meant to show up because the price of these goods is zero. So this problem gets even worse when free goods come and substitute paid physical goods, which, you know, used to cost a lot of money before. And a good example of this is an ad of Radio Shack from early 90s. Every product in this ad is now a free app on our smartphone. Like, we used to spend several hundreds or even thousands of dollars to buy GPS devices, video recorders, and audio recorders, and alarm clocks. And now we get all of these as free apps on our smartphone. So to explain exactly what I'm trying to measure in this research, so if you look at an example of a classic downward slope shaping demand curve, the rectangle which is the B, with the rectangle B here, is a producer surplus, which is basically the revenues which these firms generate, which is what shows up in GDP. The triangle A on top is the consumer surplus, which these goods generate, which is meant to directly measure how well you are from using the product. And when the price of goods goes down from a positive number to zero, the area of the triangle increases, so consumer surplus increases, but at the same time, producer surplus would decrease. So GDP would go down as goods come and substitute paid physical goods, and consumer surplus increases. Some of these online platforms have ads, but it's important to note that advertising revenues and consumer surplus need not be proportional to each other. In my own research, what I find is that even the best platforms like Facebook and Google, which are really good at extracting money from ads, still capture only a small percentage of the total surplus they generate, something like 4 to 5% in the case of Facebook. So in my research, instead of inferring consumer surplus and welfare measures from measures of production, I go and directly measure it through online choice experiments. I use different types of online choice experiments for robustness, leading to similar results. And I can do these both with and without real incentives. I'll give you an example of how we measure welfare gains from Facebook in a second. And we could do this potentially at a much larger scale and much quickly and cheaper than traditional ways of collecting data. So we do these choice experiments in three different settings, and smaller scale and university labs. We have more control over subjects, we could do experiments where we restrict activities of which they do online, install tracking software or make them change passwords, and do more involved studies, but at the expense of not having a representative sample. On a medium scale, we partner with professional market research firms, which give us representative samples of online population. And on a large scale, we use Google Consumer Surveys, which is a market research platform Google has, which lets us run quick, short questions for 10 cents a piece. So the key choice experiment, which is the easiest to scale up, which I have used in most of my studies, is a single binary discrete choice experiments. So all of us have access to a free digital good, let's say Facebook. So we ask subjects to make a choice between keeping access to the good or giving it up in exchange for a certain cash amount. We can vary this cash amount across different groups of users, aggregate responses from hundreds or thousands of subjects, and then estimate demand curves for these goods. So even when these goods are price zero, we can estimate demand curves. And we can do this with real incentives instead of just asking a hypothetical question so that the responses are incentive aligned. And this is what we do for Facebook. So just to give you an example of one of the products we study. So we have been conducting like studies to measure valuation of Facebook since 2016, where we get like online representative samples of subjects. And we do incentive compatible choice experiments. So if someone says that they'll give up Facebook for like $5 or $10 a month, they are randomly selected, some of them, and asked to follow up on their choices. So we make sure they give Facebook up or Google up or some of these other platforms up, and then they get real cash at the end of the period after they follow up on their choices. So let's see how much Americans value Facebook. So what we find is that if you can, this is a downward sloping, like shaping demand curve for Facebook. On the x-axis, it's a percentage of people who choose to keep Facebook and reject cash amounts. On the y-axis, it's the like different dollar amounts of cash which we offer to subjects. Again, these are incentive compatible like studies. So we have some of these experiments, we have offered cash amounts as high as $1,000. And as you can see, like as we keep on increasing the cash amounts, like people, respondents switch from keeping access to Facebook to giving it up and accepting the cash. If we, around 20% of the population gives it up for as little as a dollar, around 20% doesn't give it up for as high as $1,000 for a month of Facebook. Looking at the median valuations, what we find is that in 2016, when I first started running these experiments, the median valuation for a month of Facebook, like the consumer surplus which it generates, was around $48. And since then, it's falling a lot. Probably I'm also going to run similar experiments now, and it would be interesting to see if this valuation has increased in the COVID age where many of our social connections have shifted online. And not only like evaluations, but we can also look at which groups of people get the most surplus from these goods. So we can look at heterogeneity in valuations. So not surprising, but like the more you use Facebook, then the more you evaluate more, the more network size you have on Facebook, the more you evaluate more. Interestingly, like women seem to value it more and older people value it more than younger people. And we were a bit surprised by some of these results. And we did a few follow-on interviews with some of our respondents. And what we find is that if you don't have substitutes to Facebook, then you value it more. So older people are not like present on Instagram and Snapchat as much as younger people. So that's the only way they can stay in touch with their family. So they seem to value it more. And we can also look at what other platforms like our respondents use and how that impacts their valuation, looking at substitutes and complements across these services. So what we find, like for Facebook, for example, if you use like Instagram and YouTube more, you seem to value it less. So these could be potentially substitutes to some extent. So we have done similar experiments also in Europe, more in a lab setting, but looking at a bigger basket of digital goods, including WhatsApp, which is widely used there. What we find is that, again, similar downward shaping demand curves. And in terms of valuations, like WhatsApp in this European country was valued at over 500 euros a month. So generating a ton of surplus while costing nothing. And we were, again, like quite surprised by this like big number and did a bunch of interviews following up with the subjects. And what we found is that while in the US, most people still use SMS to communicate, like rest of the world, like basically people use WhatsApp, not only for professional, but also like everyday life communications with families, spend several hours a day, and it seems to be essential to basically exist. And looking also in this sample, like Facebook was at around 100 euros a month. Using maps on your phone is also quite valuable, around 60 euros a month. Other platforms in this sample were like much less valued. So we scale these experiments up using Google Surveys, which is an online platform Google offers to run quick, short surveys, like getting at representative samples online. And also Google provides us like different demographics based on the browsing history of subjects. So we could look at heterogeneity in valuations as well. So we did studies looking at how much people value different categories of goods. So giving up all search engines or like all email or like all video streaming, so you won't be able to use any substitutes. And looking at valuations for categories of goods and also some other types of goods, like for example, Wikipedia, what we found is around $150 a year of surplus, costing completely zero, like no wages, completely built by volunteers. shows up almost barely in GDP, but contributes to around $10 to $15 billion of consumer welfare a year. And then looking at the categories which I was mentioning before, search engines like are the most highly valued category of digital goods, over $15,000 of surplus for like the median American, which seems really high, but none of us would be able to, I guess, do our jobs like and do basically anything online without search engines. So it's like really hard to imagine a life without Google or Facebook, or sorry, Google and Bing and all other alternatives out there. Similarly, like maps and email valued quite highly, e-commerce as well, pretty high. And we've been running, as I was saying, these studies over time. So it would be interesting to see the latest valuations, because especially for e-commerce, it seems the market share has jumped in the last few months from 10% to over 35% of all commerce. We could do this not only for digital goods, but also for other types of goods which we use. So economists have studied a lot, like different varieties of breakfast cereal and how much welfare it generates. And so just to give you an example, so the cereal industry generates around $10 billion of like revenue, which is captured in GDP. And through our experiments, what we find is that on top of that, there is a $15 billion of consumer surplus, which it generates, which is not captured. So the gap between consumer surplus and what shows up in GDP is it's not that big, but probably for goods with positive prices, but there is still a gap. In the interest of time, let me quickly go through the remaining slides. So in a follow-on paper, we use these valuations and develop a framework to directly measure welfare. And we create a new metric of welfare, which we call GDPB, where B stands for benefits, which captures the traditional GDP and welfare derived from it for goods with prices, but also on top of that, welfare gains, which we get from free goods and also new goods such as smartphones, which are not properly captured as well. And once we develop this framework and convert the estimates which we obtain for Facebook and other goods and put this back into a framework, what we find is that Facebook alone contributes around 0.05% of extra growth in welfare on top of the traditional GDP growth, which is our GDPB metric. So that's pretty substantial just for one product. And once we account for all the digital goods, like it's a pretty big number. Let me quickly summarize the results. So what I'm trying to say is that not that we should replace GDP. GDP does a great job at measuring production. But if you want to look at welfare, we should like directly go and measure it through maybe our choice experiment approach or some other types of methods, but especially accounting for digital goods because their prices are zero. So our metric is not as precise as GDP, but it's more closer to your true well-being. What we truly care about probably is our subjective well-being and happiness and life satisfaction, which is also another metric which is interesting to measure for these goods, but not as precise as GDP. In some follow-on work, I also have some experiments looking at social media and other online platforms and how they impact our happiness and life satisfaction. So the point is, instead of looking at one number,
sorry, you're gonna have to wrap up quickly.
Yeah, so instead of looking at one number, we should be looking at a dashboard of metrics ranging from production, which is GDP, to well-being, which is happiness, and GDPB, which looks at the consumer surplus of these goods. Yeah, thank you.